Secretary in the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development, Emil Magaral, members of the media, good morning. As you all are aware, following the declaration of the March to national and regional elections, two ministers were appointed to head the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development. Both ministers will be speaking to you today. I'll invite Minister Nigel Dharamlall to talk with you and to highlight the focus of the ministry on the way forward, after which Minister Anand Persaud will brief you as well.
Thank you, Danielle, and good morning, everyone. This morning, we do not expect our press conference to be very long, but we hope that whatever we present to you, you'd be able to capture us concisely and be able to share it with our country likewise. The Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development under the new dispensation is of the firm belief that we have to work assiduously to bring our communities closer to our government. And by that I mean bridging the gap between the government and the citizens of our country. And we believe that this can only be done by stronger collaboration, by working closer together, by listening to our citizens, and I think most importantly, reacting positively to the issues, to the concerns, the observations, and even the complaints that our citizens make on behalf of their families, on behalf of their communities, and on behalf of the national collective. The Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development, in the Manifesto of the People's Progressive Party Civic, we have outlined a vision which we believe is going to enhance and improve the relationship that we have with our citizens. And I think more importantly, it will serve to create an atmosphere where all involved, at the national level, at the regional level, and at the local level, that there is a singular space in which we all operate. A singular space meaning that our ministry, as outlined by the President in both speeches at his swearing-in and at his inauguration, that the government will be in service to our people. And in doing so, our approach to work would be one where we will consult, we will collaborate on decisions, on policies, before they are implemented. So a bottom-up approach to governance, a bottom-up approach to management is how we see our ministry evolving in the local government and regional development sectors in support of the other sectors of our economy and of our country. As you're aware, local government and regional development play a critical role in enhancing people's lives. The ministry straddles 10 regions, and it is our intention that every single person, irrespective of where they live in this country, they will get the support, they will get the service of the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development. The Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development has, as part of its structure, 10 regional democratic councils, 17 neighborhood democratic councils, and 10 municipalities. And all of these local bodies and regional bodies are supported also by community development councils. It is our intention from the get-go that we will establish in every single part of this structure an information system that provides feedback an information system that is almost immediately responsive to the needs and concerns of our citizens and our residents. And it is our expectation that every RDC will now have an issue log register. Every NDC will have an issue log register. Every municipality, including the city of Georgetown, will have an issue log register, whether it will be a physical register or a virtual register. In either form, we expect that our citizens will have access to these offices and to these bodies where services can be provided. And we will allocate from the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development centrally officers who will respond and react immediately to all of these registers. We have also, as we move forward in the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development, the manifesto of the People's Progressive Party Civic speaks heavily to local government and local governance, where citizens will have to take ownership of leadership within their communities. And we will enhance, moving forward, we will enhance the skill set, we will enhance the support provided to residents within our local bodies and within our regions so that they can be the core leaders at the local level. And we intend to do so by promoting effective governance, and as I said, which will ensure greater benefit to our citizens across all sectors. We will also be providing greater empowerment support to local communities, which will allow them to manage their affairs. And as you are aware, when we came into office many years ago, we were the first government to have local government and regional local government elections in place in 1994, and it is also the mandate of President Irfan Ali that local government elections will continue. We also will pursue greater support to the local organs as stipulated by the laws of Guyana. And by that, we mean that whatever we do has to do within the confines of law and order. We believe that safe and secure communities are imperative to a wholesome life and are important also to national well-being. We will continue to strengthen the capacity of our local organs. One of the weaknesses of the local governance system is the capacity of local support, the local leaders to provide services to our villages and to our communities. So the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development intends to vigorously strengthen those local organs to ensure that they become more efficient and effective in their relationships with our citizens. We also intend to pursue very quickly an increase in the subvention provided to the NDCs, the Neighborhood Democratic Councils, as well as the municipalities, because in the 70 NDCs and the 10 municipalities, they require substantial financial support. And with the intervention of the government, we will be increasing the subvention currently provided. We will also be supporting our local government bodies to manage resources and to take on greater responsibility where the infrastructure of our communities are concerned. I think one of the things that we have noticed across this country is the deterioration of our infrastructure, the dilapidated state of the infrastructure in our country. And we would like our local bodies to begin as part of their enhancing the lives of our citizens to begin to take control and management of our infrastructure. The Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development, through the RDCs, have many programs in agriculture, in health, in education, in public works. So those are things that we will pursue with our sister ministries through different departments of the Regional Democratic Councils. We will also have to vigorously pursue strengthening the planning and budgeting systems of our local organs. Remember, local organs are comprised of individuals like you and I, who are elected, sometimes even without their wanting to do so, but they do it because the residents would like them to do so. And we have to provide support in those areas so that they can become transparent and they can become more accountable to the citizens that they serve. One of the critical areas of this country has to do with solid waste management, a solid waste management program. And it is our intention from the local level to the national level that the government will play a greater role and a more critical role in enhancing the solid waste management program of our country across villages and throughout the length and breadth of Guyana. And whilst we say all of this, we are operating in an atmosphere of great depression. And what I mean by that is that whilst our residents are looking forward and having so many expectations as we take office, the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development has many challenges. In our first few days of work, one of the things we did was to go into the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development, myself and the Honorable Minister Anand Persaud, and to work with the technical staff, the heads of department, to get an understanding of what the current situation at the ministry is in the form of a situational analysis. And this is what we found. We found that in the Minister's Secretariat in the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development, there were 23 staff who were earning as much in total per month, $7.730 million per month, 23 staff. And who were those staff? Those staff happened to be elements which we believe were part of the political machinery at that time of the government. And from our records in the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development, we have been unable to verify and to validate the performance of these staff because there is no record of their work, there is no documentation of their work, and since we took office, there has been no presence of their person in the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development. And I'll give you some examples. There is one advisor, a special ministerial advisor on local government, who was earning $418,674 per month, a duty allowance, non-taxable duty allowance of $25,000 per month, a telephone allowance of $15,000 per month, Oscar Clark. And since we have taken office, we have not seen him. And from the reports that we have received, is that this individual turned up to work 3 half-days per week, earning this monument almost, when you add it all up, possibly close to $500,000 per month. We also have a special ministerial, despite we have a Ministry of Agriculture, the Minister of Local Government and Communities at that time had a special advisor in Rupert Hopkinson, who was earning $376,807 per month, with a non-taxable allowance of $70,000 per month, a telephone allowance of $10,000 per month landline. And we've had We also had an advisor to the minister. We had, as a matter of fact, we had two advisors to the minister, Carmichael Thorne and Samuel Parris. Carmichael Thorne was earning $88,250 per month, plus $30,000 per month in non-taxable allowances and telephone, as well as a traveling allowance of $20,000 per month. That is over $500,000 per month. And we have no record of any of the work that they would have done. And these are individuals whose contracts were renewed even after the no confidence motion was passed, and renewed for a substantial period. So their contracts are also in effect, but the fact that they have not yet turned up to work, it means that they are in terrible breach of their contracts. We also have in the community, there is a department in the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development called the Community Councils Department. And from the names we have perused, these are all political operatives of the APNUAFC. They are apparently stationed in the regions. And when I spoke to some of the REOs, they themselves were not supervising these individuals. For example, the former Member of Parliament of the APNUAFC in Region 6, Barbara Pilgrim, is on the payroll of the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development for $210,982 per month, a non-taxable allowance of $10,000 per month, and a telephone allowance of $10,000 per month. And I can go through the names with you. Manbod Rahman, Darwell Khan, Carol Nurse from Region 5, the area that I come from. She is also on the... So there are very many of them. I think one of the conspicuous names is Ganesh Mahipal. Ganesh Mahipal is on the payroll of the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development, assigned to the Regional Democratic Council of Region Number 3, earning a salary as a community development officer, and contracted since the August 1st, 2015, of $210,982 per month, with a duty allowance, a non-taxable duty allowance of $10,000 per month. So this is a person who I have seen here during the national recount, and this is a person who is on the pensionable establishment of the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development, involved in heavy political work as a public servant. And there is no documentation, there is no validation of the work that this individual has done for the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development. One of the former, I think, ministers, a junior minister of agriculture in the PNC government, Simpson De Silva, he is listed as a technical assistant of the in the ministry, earning $342,416 per month, $10,000 per month non-taxable duty allowance, and telephone allowance of $10,000 per month, and an internet allowance of $10,000 per month. And there are very many others. You will also know of Lachman Aziz in Region 5, earning $194,752 per month, a non-taxable duty allowance, $10,000 per month, and a telephone allowance, $5,000 per month. When we add up the 36 persons in the Secretariat of the Community Development Council, the CDC, their total salaries per month is $5,898,167 per month. This is just their salaries. This excludes their allowances. And there is no record of their work. And imagine when you 7 and 5, 12 and 1, $13.5 million per month between Bulkan Secretariat and the CDC, $13.5 million per month. In 5 years, you do the math. Hundreds of millions of dollars. Hundreds of millions of dollars. The last government paid out, and there is no evidence of work provided by 53 persons in the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development. That is, in 5 years, 13.5 million dollars per month. PS, that is supposed to work out to about $160 million per year on average. You multiply that by 5 years, because these are people still on the payroll. By 5 years, that is over $800 million that these 56 persons have earned without, earned on the backs of taxpayers without evidence of their effort. And we cannot countenance this. The Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development will hold everyone accountable for all expenses done without due process. The Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development will ensure that as we move forward, that everyone who works for that ministry and in support of that ministry will exude the greatest of professionalism, the greatest of competence, and the greatest of respect in the conduct of our duties. That is the minimum with which we will work, and that is the minimum standard that our President, His Excellency Dr. Irfan Ali, has set for all of us. We will also be working very closely with other ministries, as I indicated to you, because the Local Government and Regional Development Ministry cuts across all sectors of our country. We intend to, as part of our manifesto, ensure that there is enhanced infrastructural development in our communities, roads, bridges. We will have to be working very closely with the Ministry of Public Works to ensure electrification in our communities. We will have to work very closely with the Ministry of Home Affairs to ensure that there is greater security and safety in our villages. We would have to work very closely with the Ministry of Agriculture to ensure that our small farmers, especially the household farmers, the even those who are employed in the larger sectors of the economy, that their conditions are also uplifted and enhanced. As part of the regional development system, we also intend to, as part of the direction of His Excellency the President, that we will rebuild the economic infrastructure in our regions, and we will enhance the economic infrastructure in our regions. And by that we mean that every region with their own peculiarities can expect greater investment, can expect more developed infrastructure, and they can expect all of this being done with their support and their collaboration. We will not, like I said earlier, go into villages or any community and impose government, but our approach to work as we move forward would be one where the residents and the citizens of our country, the residents of our villages and the citizens of our country will work hand in hand with us as we bridge that gap that exists between government and citizenry, bridge that gap, making decisions together, making policies together, so that over the next 5 years, we are going to have better households, we are going to have safer communities, we are going to have enhanced infrastructure, and we are going to have thousands of persons employed in the rural areas of Guyana, in the hinterland of Guyana, in the municipalities of Guyana. It is part of our promise to provide 50,000 jobs, and it is every intention of the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development to work with the other ministries and to work on the vision that the President has outlined so that these things can be realized over the next 5 years. Those are my earlier comments to you. I'd now like to invite Minister Anand Persaud to also share with you some of the issues that he would like to share with you. Then we will take your questions. But just before I leave the podium, I'd like to say to you that I met with Minister Persaud and I met with His Worship the Mayor this morning. We had a very cordial meeting. We paid a courtesy call. We went to City Hall, to the Mayor's office, and we met with the Mayor and the Deputy Mayor. Like I said, we discussed generally a renewed relationship. We discussed generally how we would like to work more closely with the residents of Georgetown and what is our modus operandi in collaborating with the Georgetown mayors and city councilors, and what is our modus operandi in the reverse where the city council operates with government. It is part of the view of the government and the mandate, as a matter of fact, of the government, that we will have to elevate Georgetown to a higher level. And very soon, the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development will establish an interministerial committee that will work very closely with the residents of Georgetown and, of course, the councillors too, to make sure that that elevation happens very soon and it happens in the best interests of national development. Secondly, we are working very closely with under the direction of the President and the support of the Honorable Prime Minister, our ministry and the Ministry of Amerindian Affairs. We have to reach out as part of the COVID pandemic crisis in Guyana. We have to reach out into our communities, and we have begun the first phase where two communities in two regions of Guyana, very vulnerable, but the situation is exploding in regions 9 and 8, and specifically to the villages in region 8, Canapan, contiguous to the Brazilian border, and you're aware Brazil has a massive, the effect of the pandemic is massive in Brazil. So those villages in the North Pacaraima is contiguous to the border, Canapang, Itabak, somewhere in Corocobaru, Tusening, Bamboo Creek, we will be taking in food hampers and other supplies into those regions. And we will be doing the same tomorrow in the Rupununi, in the Wowet in the north, and Arnaputa, Anai Central, Ruperti, those villages have some concerns. Then we will have to go to South Central, Potaranau, Baitun, Katur, Sholinab, and in Central Letem, Central Rupununi, close to Letem, Kwaiko. Those villages are earmarked for support immediately as we start to roll out our COVID support into those communities. We are providing great assistance to and support to the Ministry of Health, which is leading the national COVID effort. And there are regional, every region has a task force, so regional task forces are in every region. And I've met with, and myself and Minister Persaud, with the REOs and the regional task force, including some councillors, and they require lots of support. Some regions have indicated to us that since in March, when the pandemic started to explode in Guyana, they have not really received proper support. So it is something that was of great concern, and it is on the front burner of our work agenda. So a lot of effort is also being placed in terms of us fighting the COVID pandemic. Thank you very much, and I'll invite Minister Anand Persaud.
Honorable Minister Nigel Dharamlall, ladies and gentlemen of the media, let me first of all say from the outset that when we went into the ministry, we did what you call a familiarization process with the staff there. And we unearthed quite a number of things. One that the Honorable Minister Nigel Dharamlall mentioned was party hacks of the APNU AFC who were employed as contract workers and drawing down millions of dollars on a monthly basis. What they do, we are yet to find out, or if they had done anything in the past. And we are looking at that very, very carefully and seriously. I want to tell the citizens of all 10 administrative regions that we intend to work to enhance their regions, their communities, and moreover, the welfare of the citizens. And that is to do with roads, lights, water, drainage and irrigation. And here is where the Ministry itself of Local Government and Regional Development may not be directly involved, but with assistance from the respective lead ministry. We have had meetings virtually with all the 10 regions, with the REOs and the regional health officers, because this pandemic, COVID-19, is not only important to us, but to all of us in this world. And we are taking necessary steps to ensure that all the protocols are followed. Very shortly, myself and the Honorable Minister Dharamlall will start making field visits within the 10 administrative regions to listen to the concerns of the citizens and to see how best we can assist them in the next 5 years. You know, as it is, the Treasury is empty. We don't have a budget for over 2 years, and the government and His Excellency the President, Dr. Muhammad Irfan Ali, and Vice President, Dr. Bar Jagdeo, they're working on the budget. Hopefully that will be out shortly, and monies will be available to start helping the citizens of the 10 regions. I think, and I know, that Minister Dharamlall covered the rest, so it makes no sense for me to reiterate what he said. I think we can take some questions now.
Local government elections will continue. A date has not yet been fixed for local government elections. I think that we have only recently took up office, and the fact that I mention it means that it is on our front burner. And as soon as the preparations are in order, that those will be made known and publicly known. Well, naturally, the priority for us in the new budget we intend to hit the ground running immediately. And our priorities will be to deal with enhanced governance. Our priorities will also focus on solid waste management, which is one of the critical areas of our need in our country. We will also be building activities that are important to enhancing the relationship between our residents and the government. We would be focused, as Minister Anand Persaud said, on local infrastructure almost immediately, on local utilities almost immediately. And in the next few weeks, we will begin the consultations on the regional economic plans that we intend to pursue in every region.
And just
Yes, certainly. Under the directive of the President, he has indicated, His Excellency has indicated that he would like the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development to lead an interministerial committee involving the Ministry of Public Works, Home Affairs, Health to some extent, the Ministry of Culture, Youth and Sport, because we would like to have Georgetown elevated to the real capital city that it ought to be. There is a lot of work to be done in the city. There are tremendous challenges facing the Georgetown mayor and city councillors, and more importantly, there are tremendous challenges facing the citizens of Georgetown, including residents and businesses. So that interministerial committee will be activated very shortly, and we expect it to be before the end of this week.
Can you say who or what body will be governing this committee?
Well, like I said, it is a cabinet-directed committee, and it will be led by the Minister of Local Government and Regional Development, and the ministers would be involved in it.
Thank you. And Mr. Anand Persaud, you mentioned that you guys conducted virtual meetings with persons within the region. Can you say directly who were these persons that came forward to have this meeting with you guys?
Those were the REOs of all 10 administrative regions and the regional health officers. What we basically discussed was COVID-19, the pandemic, and we were fully briefed, and that is where it is at this point in time.
Thank you.
Well, that matter is being treated on a case-by-case basis, and we have to reach out to these individuals. I think for all intents and purposes, they did not turn up to work because, like I had indicated earlier, these may be political operatives and who have now descended into opposition. So those are our comments at this point in time. Nevertheless, I want to reassure everyone that the Ministry of Local Government and Regional Development is open to all Guyanese and is open to anyone of any political persuasion, as long as you are competent, you are professional, and you would like to work in development of your country, then we are free and we are happy to receive your applications. Yeah, actually, there are structures in place. It is really for the structures to work. In every region, for example, there is what you call an RTB or a regional tender board. There is also, at the local level, there is supposed to have been the regional tender board deals with the expenses or the procurement of the NDCs. We also mentioned to you that we intend to vigorously pursue training and development to staff, and not just staff alone, but willing persons within communities so that there is a wider catchment of skills moving forward.
The municipalities, earlier last year, the mayors of the varying municipalities have mentioned that they have some issues with
The laws are very fluid. Bylaws are also very fluid. The situation in countries' development is also very fluid. So we have to make sure that whatever we do, we have to consult with. And that is one of the reasons why I mentioned from the outset the importance of closing the gap between government and the citizens. We will not engage without consultation. And very soon we will be meeting with all of the mayors or the municipalities, and we are going to have these discussions. One of the things that we are very vehement about is that we are not here as a government to deteriorate people's lives. We are not here to sledgehammer any household. We are here to uplift. So as part of that exercise, or as part of that mandate, we have to make sure that whatever we do it in the best interests of our citizens.
My final question, sorry, I'm not trying to help you. IBC is going forward. We just had regional elections. Can you outline for us how the process will go forward in terms of assigning the new councils and selecting a new chairman, if that's what happens, and whether or not areas will need to change? I'm not sure how the system works.
Right. Maybe we could start with the last one first. The REOs are political appointees, and as long as they work professionally and competently in service of their office and in the execution of the mandate of the RDC, then we would have no problem. If, however, they are not working in the interest of what is before them, then we would have to look at that on a case-by-case basis. In terms of the councillors and the chairs and vice chairs of the RDCs, these are being consulted on, at least right now, insofar as the People's Progressive Party Civic is concerned, which is the governing party right now. There is consultation in every region to arrive at the best candidates who will be elected as or selected as councillors. That approach is being done regionally, and it is being done in consultation with the candidates and the local or regional leaders. So we intend to have the best service out of them. In securing who they are, we would be looking at some geographic indicators, we would be looking at demographic indicators, we'd be looking at gender, we want to have a wide gender representation in terms of gender. We would like to have quite a lot of young people also on the councils. You notice the president and his cabinet are about 20 years younger on average than the previous government. So we would like also to have the RDCs well represented with young people. The chair and vice will be, after the councillors are sworn in, then the chair and vice will be elected.
Have any other questions?
All right, well, if you don't have any other question, my number is 600-8868, and you are free to WhatsApp me at any time. If you call and then you don't get through, just send me a message. And the number for Minister Anand Persaud, I hope he doesn't mind me give you, is 624-9017. So we gave you our cell number, so you are free to contact us at any time. Sorry? 600-8868.